Next session, a very great privilege, pleasure also to introduce our next speaker, John Michael Greer. If Hugh and Matt had done their job accurately, John Michael's work will have already been presented to you, so I won't say much more about it. Did they do a good job?
To the extent that you can get through all of it in an hour,
I'm very yeah. And in a way, moved us in the direction towards John Michael's talk about what difference can one person make. So without further ado, I'll hand over to John Michael Greer.
Thank you. I'm impressed that this many people turned out on a Sunday morning to listen to or take part in a class of a conference about a subject that many people in this and most industrial societies avoid, I would say like the plague, but far more people are interested in the plague. Nonetheless, it is something we need to talk about because this is a reality that is already shaping our lives now. It's going to shape our lives even more extensively in the future. And it's a matter of dealing with it or being dealt with it, being dealt by with it. I mean, we can ignore it, but it's not going to ignore us. And it's important to get that in our minds. And one of the questions that I often field in conversations like this is, well, when is it going to happen? When are we actually going to run up against the limits to growth? When is the economy going to start to fall apart? When are ecosystems going to begin to break down? As though that's not happening. Those of you who have been watching the economics, of course we all know that the economy is in recovery, it's just that nobody's working. And of course the environment is just fine by some values of the term fine. And in fact, as we saw, all of the metrics being tracked by the limits to growth model, the rejected, derided, denounced limits to growth model that everybody's been yelling about since 1972, all those metrics are still on track. The alternative predictions made by people who are insisting, no, it's fine, none of this stuff is going to happen, their predictions have proven to be reliably inaccurate. The limits to growth, quite the contrary. And it's important at this point, late in the day as it is, that we start paying attention to that and say, okay, this is shaping the rest of our lives. This is shaping our lives right now. It's not going to stop. What are we going to do about it? Now, when that question is raised, almost always the immediate response on the part of most people is, well, there's nothing I can do about it. It's got to be someone else, them. Who them? It's got to be the governments, it's got to be corporations, it's got to be big charities, it's got to be the Space Brothers who are going to land and fix it all. You might not be amazed. I was certainly amazed at the number of people who contacted me insisting that alien intelligences from other galaxies have nothing better to do with their time than to fix our messes for us. God's got to take care of it. Do you have a big rapture scene in the UK? Lots of people who are waiting to be beamed up by St. Scotty onto the USS Enterprise so that they don't have to clean up their mess? Everybody wants somebody else to take care of it, and it's becoming increasingly clear that no one else is taking care of it, and we're left with that question, okay, what can I do about it? It's very easy to insist that it's not something that an individual can deal with. Partly, that's because it is a huge thing. We're talking a global problem here. It's a big planet. We're little, we're just fairly small social mammals. But it's also easy to say, well, what can I do about it? Because doing something about it requires making changes in our own lives, in our own lifestyles, in how we go about things from day to day. It's what the statue of Apollo said to Renio Maria Rilke. Du musst dein Leben ändern. You must change your life. You cannot be part of the solution if the way you're living is part of the problem. I call this the Al Gore effect, for reasons that will doubtless be clear to those of you who... Am I coming across audibly? I know some people in the back straining to hear me. Are we good? Okay, we're good. one of the problems that the climate change activism has had over the years, the part of the process that has taken it from an apparently unstoppable force 20 years ago to dead in the water now, is that a huge number of people who were making a great deal of noise about climate change showed no willingness to adapt their own lives to a zero carbon basis. And there are a couple of factors there. On the one hand, most people at this point are very used to the folks going around going, you've got to change what you're doing or we're all going to die a horrible death. You know that line. It's been used for about the last 2,000 years over and over and over again. If I may indulge in a briefly ethnocentric comment, one of the classics of early American literature dating from back when we were still a colony of yours is a sermon titled Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God. It's a great piece of horror fiction in its own way. It was extremely popular in colonial audiences, building up this terrifying image of God literally holding human souls above the abyss, ready to drop them into hell. And it got a lot of mileage for the time. People have been trying to do the same thing ever since. Exactly which abyss we're about to be flung into varies from time to time. But most political activists of left, of right, of off the scale, still use that as their primary stock in trade. You've got to do this or something horrible will happen. The problem is many people are used to that at this point. And trying to hammer on that over and over again only works if you show any signs of taking it seriously yourself. So, for example, our fundamentalist preachers who rant at the top of their lungs about sexual misbehavior and then go off and practice it the other 6 days of the week, have had very limited success in getting their agenda through because everyone knows they're just exercising their lungs. There's nothing to it. In the same way, Al Gore and a great many people like him who are perfectly willing to talk about how we all have to move to a carbon-free future, but not me, not now. I want my, umpty dozen room air-conditioned mansion in Tennessee, thank you. And my frequent flyer miles, by the way. And so people simply dismiss that. They dismiss that sort of activism out of hand as just somebody exercising their lungs. But of course, there's another dimension. Because to the extent that each of us benefits from the existing way of doing things, to the extent that each of us profits from that, is used to that, depends on that, our likelihood of actually changing those things from which we profit and on which we depend is really fairly low. We may push for changes in anything else, but we're not going to change that, not in any way that really matters. We saw a lot of that, we've seen a lot of that over the last 40 years. People who are very deeply concerned about this or that or the other, as long as it doesn't affect their pocketbooks, which means that in effect they're not concerned at all. We need to change our lives. We need to start with our own lives because that's the only way we can make a convincing case to anybody. We need to start with our own lives because that's the only way we can be sure of our own integrity in this situation. But we also need to start with our own lives because of the process. I'm going to give it a fancy word briefly and then we can explain what I'm talking about. The process of mimesis, which is the basis for most human social activity. You all know mimesis. It's the six-year-old running around saying, "I'm Spider-Man!" Okay? It's the process of the imitation. All social primates do most of their learning by mimesis. Humans see, human do. You know how it goes. And people will follow a lead if somebody is actually demonstrating it. This was the great and unlearned lesson of the 1970s appropriate technology movement. There were a lot of people back then who were, starting out as very few of them, putting in the backyard gardens, putting the solar water heaters on their roofs, doing without a car, doing various other things. And the immediate reaction that people had was, what a bunch of weirdos. And the second reaction was, you're saving how much money? And you start having mimesis. That all got stomped by the Thatcher-Reagan counter-revolution right around 1980. It got stomped very efficiently, and it partly got stomped because there were a lot of people who were very willing to let go of that, put pedal to the metal, and go back to a comfortable lifestyle. Unfortunately, that probably flushed our one chance of having a smooth transition to the lower energy future that we're facing. Now, please note, I'm not saying that it flushed our chance of a transition. One way or another, we are going to a lower energy future. As fossil fuels run short, as we start running up against hard limits to what renewables can actually produce without an energy subsidy from petroleum and other fossil fuels. We're going back to that one way or the other. The question is, how rough is the road there? It's going to be rougher than it might have been if we'd kept on building on the possibilities of the 1970s. We still got to make the transition, and we can still make it a lot easier than it will otherwise be. And that's where mimesis is called for. That's where individual people making changes in their own lives, getting rid of the car, using public transit even when it's inconvenient. Okay. Usually, if this were an American crowd, and thus much ruder, somebody would stand up right now and say, well, I bet you own a car. Actually, I don't. I've never owned a car. I've never had a driver's license. I got into this stuff back in the 1970s and never saw a point in changing that. And I live in a city of 20,000 people in north central Appalachia, in a fairly impoverished set part of North America, where the public transit really sucks. It's okay. You can make it work. The willingness to accept a little bit of inconvenience, to accept a little bit of poverty, terrifying word. Most middle-class people would rather dine daily on live tarantulas than let anybody think that they're poor. It's one of those things. You're gonna have to face that one. And it's a real fear. It's a real fear. Those of us who come from middle-class backgrounds, most of our families clawed our way up out of the working class in the post-war period or immediately before it, and are desperate to try to maintain that distance that our grandparents, whoever, so painfully earned. But the fact is, we are all going to be poor by modern standards in a lower energy future. Right now, your average middle class person in this country, as well as in the United States, has privileges and benefits that emperors didn't get 500 years ago. We are insanely rich by the standards of every other human society that's ever lived. It's going to be awkward to get rid of that. If you think of yourself briefly as a deposed emperor, you know, the emperor's gone away. You've been kicked out of the palace. You have to go someplace and make a living somehow. You are not going to be, you know, doing the imperial thing anymore. Yes, I understand that's traumatic, but you do have to live with it. So, better to be a deposed emperor than a naked one, I suppose. But so there are a great many things that can be done in terms of making changes in our own lives. I want to talk about two of them in specific, two categories, I would say, specifically in this context. Not because they're the only options out there, but because they may give you an example of some of the possibilities that are available once you start thinking outside the box, once you start thinking outside the rigid mindsets of our contemporary industrial culture, which prides itself on every kind of diversity except the one between your ears. Okay. The first one is I'm going to give it a fancy name again, disintermediation of your economic life. No, disintermediation. What does that mean? How many of you depend on pieces of paper with the Queen's picture on them for basically everything you have, everything you do, everything you use? That means that you are accepting the mediation of the financial industry in everything you do. Whatever you do, the Bank of England's taking a cut. Whatever you do, the banking system, the whole tottering superstructure of the tertiary economy, is taking their cut out of every transaction you make. It seems so obvious that we should go ahead and, you know, spend the money, do that thing. Here's the trick. If you leave money out of the situation, you get to keep that cut. In an expanding economy, the cut's fairly small and you don't greatly have to worry about it. In a stagnant economy, the cut is larger and becomes a problem. In a contracting and declining economy, that cut can go straight to the jugular. And so as the global economy continues to come unraveled, disintermediating your economic life away from the money economy is a key factor. How do you do that? One obvious way is to do things yourself. When you brew your own beer, you don't have to pay yourself for each glass. Now, you may have to use some money to get to get some of the materials, but the raw materials are a lot cheaper than the finished product. Since you're putting in all the labor, you're doing it on your own time. You're providing the space for the fermentation to take place and all this kind of stuff. There's a lot of money that you're paying for if you buy beer, but you're not paying for if you make it. Now, of course, this also makes you everybody's friend, especially when after 6 months or so, you can make something better than the slop from the big breweries. Now, I have to say, over here, even your big breweries are better than ours. Nothing on this planet is as bad as cheap American beer. You can't even use it to kill slugs these days. The slugs turn up their noses and slither away. Those of you who haven't tried to taste of Coors Light don't yet know what I'm talking about. Spare yourself the experience. But the fact is, if you know how to brew good beer, everybody is your friend. If Attila the Hun rides up to the door, hand him a cold one. He's not going to ravage your house, he'll do the rest of the ones on the block. So there are, I don't know that you have Attila the Hun to expect anytime soon. We'll get to that eventually, but probably not in our lifetimes. But at any rate, getting that process underway, getting that disintermediation underway, is an important part of extracting yourself from the grips of the financial economy and saving money that you can put to other uses. If you are in a situation, okay, actually, here's a common situation. I don't know how common it is on this side of the water. In America, it's extremely common, where you have a two-income family, and they're convinced that they have to have two incomes. If you actually add up the amount of money they are spending to support that second income, the hired child care, the extra car, the business clothing, all the other things that they have to pay for rather than simply having one member of the family do, they're actually losing money. They would have a higher standard of living if one person stayed home and they were on one income. It's quite common. Very often they won't do it because all the people think about is the number. How many pounds am I getting in per month? Without thinking of how much am I paying out, how much productive value can the household economy produce? 100 years ago, it was probably half the economic value in this country. 200 years ago, it was considerably more than half. The household was the basic unit of economic production. Now, I should say, for the benefit of those with liberated views, that I'm not talking about all the women staying home. I've been a house husband. It works. There are many situations where, in a couple, you know, which member of the couple is better suited to stay in the job market, which one is better suited to stay home, may have nothing to do with gender issues at all, and we will leave untouched the question of same-sex unions, where obviously that's not going to be much of an issue. But it makes sense to look at that and look at what can we produce at home? How can we extract ourselves from the conventional, financially mediated, increasingly corrupt, increasingly predatory economic system that we have now, and start doing what people in every other society in every other corner of the world have done throughout human history and produce much of what we need at home, either for our own use or for exchange with our neighbors? That's disintermediation. And that's one basic element that I'd like to suggest you consider. Of course, there are many others. Equally, there are many other ways of disintermediating than what I've just talked about. Solar water heaters used to be absolutely standard. 100 years ago, that was a mature technology, and you had it even in Britain. I'm familiar with the skies here. I grew up in Seattle. It's not that different. Even in a place like this, you can routinely shave 10 to 15% of your annual energy bill by using a solar water heater whenever the sun's out. There's a certain upfront investment, but it means that you have hot water anytime the sun's shining, whether or not the fuel is still flowing, and of course that's increasingly becoming an issue. Britain, like the United States, has been through a recent period of, hey, we've got plenty of energy. How are those North Sea fields doing now? Exactly. It's very easy to get caught up in that notion that a temporary surplus is the equivalent of a problem solved. And unfortunately, the Thatcher government and its successors drew down the North Sea fields at a breakneck pace. Our presidential administrations did, from Reagan on, did exactly the same thing with the Alaska North Slope. A resource that could have, in our case, is a resource that could have lasted probably 100 years, reached its peak production in 14 years and is now dropping like a rock. That's one of the unmentioned issues behind America's little economic difficulties. We're employment. We can get into fracking if you really want to. The short form is, don't do it. It's a scam. Okay. So disintermediation, one option. What can you produce yourself, whether it's heat, whether it's food, whether it's beer, whether it's whatever, without depending on the money economy? Okay. The other thing I want to talk about is something a little subtler, and thus in some ways a little more difficult. Because one of the reasons that it's so easy not to make the changes, that it's so easy to say, oh, I'm sure they'll think of something. I hate those words. and all the rest of it, is the extent to which we have internalized an idea of not merely economic growth, but progress. Most people in the modern industrial world believe in progress the way that medieval peasants believed in the wonder-working powers of the bones of the local saint. Okay? Progress is our hope of salvation. It's where our sense of meaning and purpose and value come from as human beings. I mean, people who have, you know, they're not astronauts. They don't ever expect to do anything in outer space. It's just something they watch on their TV. And yet, if you suggest, we're actually at peak technology, not just peak oil. We're actually at the point where future technologies are going to be much less complex. We are not going to be doing a Star Trek future metastasizing across the galaxy. Sorry. They can't deal with it. Oh my God, you mean we're stuck on this rock? Seriously, that's a phrase that people have used. Because progress, well, basically the collapse of Christianity as an effective framework for social life across the Western world was followed by, as such things usually are in the life of civilizations, desperately scrambling around looking for some substitute, something that would fill the same void and serve the same social functions without requiring belief in anything supernatural. It's a very standard phenomenon. In the case of Western industrial civilization, what we lighted on is progress. And people put a lot of faith in progress. And this is why telling people, we're not going to progress out of this. They're not going to think of something where we may progress right off a cliff. Runs into a hard wall of disbelief. Because, well, this is progress. It's got to save us. They'll think of something. There must be some way we can keep on zooming off to that imaginary future we watch on the television every day. And to get your heads around the possibility that need not be the case, that no good fairy promised us a future out there among the stars, that it was something that people made up as a belief system, and that the great god Progress is dead, pushing up daisies. That's a really hard challenge. But it's a challenge that I want to challenge each of you to take on. To think about what kind of shape does your life make if we are not going off this rock? If our species is going to continue living on this planet for as long as it continues to exist, be that 1 million years or 10 million years, here we are. What kind of a mess have we made of it? And what does that mean in terms of our own values, our own behavior? If this is the only home our species has, the only place, the only world we will ever know, what does that do? I encourage you to wrestle with this and to think about why it is that so many people have become so obsessive about this idea of progress, why it functions as a religious role, and what happens if you look up at the sky and God and his saints and angels aren't there anymore, so to speak. If the great god Progress is not in his temple, what does that mean for your life? What does it mean for the lives of other people? That's also a kind of disintermediation, by the way. Those of you who have a background in psychology may have encountered a very common dodge that people have, which is to say, Well, I'll deal with all my problems as soon as I lose 20 pounds. I'll deal with all my problems as soon as I leave my spouse. I'll deal with all my problems as soon as I get a better job. Okay? It's a very common dodge. And that kind of putting off everything toward the future is actually the basis of the faith in progress. Well, our lives today may suck. We may have an unjust, corrupt, dilapidated society that's circling the drain, but our descendants will live among the stars. How often have you heard that? How many of you have thought it? It's part of the basic furniture of our minds. And what does it mean when we stop believing that? And we start saying, okay, we're not going to get pie in the sky when you die, to borrow a line from the Wobblies. The sky in this case being, of course, orbiting around Alpha Centauri. We're not going to get that future. And that kind of provisional living that I was just talking about, the notion of putting off everything that matters until X happens in the future. And of course, X never gets around to happening, that's the whole point of it. You never lose that 20 pounds. You never leave your spouse. You never get that new job. And that makes it possible for you to continue muddling through every day, leaving all your hopes on hold, because you don't want to confront the challenge, the very real challenge, of actually bringing them into existence. We are hip deep in provisional living in the modern world, collectively, and sinking rapidly. And I don't think it's a good strategy anymore. So, the idea of pursuing our goals ourselves instead of mediating them out to some future generation, the idea of producing wealth ourselves with our own hands, with our own tools, instead of mediating it out to someone who will do it for us in exchange for a cut. All of these are important parts of a response to the challenges of our time. It would be nice to be able to say, well, we don't have to do that. But again, as I mentioned, doing it on a mass level has been tried over and over again. It is not working. Things are just getting worse. Such progress as was made back in the day, back in the 1970s, back in the 60s and 70s, in the heyday of the appropriate tech movement and so on, it was all predicated on making changes in our own lives and building from there. Starting, if you recall the diagram of nested circles, starting with the individual, moving to the household, moving to the community, and reshaping ideas, paradigms, worldviews, starting with ourselves, starting with looking at the insides of our own heads and saying, okay, why does this not make sense? Why does the conflict between my understanding of the world and what's actually going on in it, and what should that be telling me? So those are some of the issues that I want to raise now, because I don't want to just stand here talking to an audience. I'm going to start calling for questions at this point, see if we can turn this into a conversation, and see if we can get it into places that will lead it where you want to go. Okay, don't everyone stick up your hand at once. Go ahead.
So do you think that it makes sense, and I follow the argument about sort of lessen disintermediation, mm-hmm. that it means being closer to the reality of how things are being produced and what is being produced.
Uh-huh.
Do you think we can still perhaps maintain some kind of economies in terms of sharing knowledge of things rather than everyone just sort of reinventing the wheel, mm-hmm. as it were? Not to sort of be negatively on that point, but do you think that can also be achieved in a different way?
Of course. The thing is, economies beyond the individual household scale go back probably as long as our species does. I mean, the unit of human survival is the community, not the individual. Whether we're talking hunter-gatherer bands, tribal villages, working up from there, and you generally have information storage and exchange, whether that's in the form of orally memorized chants or what have you. Right now, we have the advantage of information systems that are capable of transmitting a vast amount of information very quickly. Most of us have access to those systems. I see no reason not to use them, while having in mind the fact those systems may not be around indefinitely, and beginning to work on backups. One of the many ends of the stack of things I have not tried to get to, just briefly, is reactivation of disused technologies. Because there are a lot of ways to do things that do not require the same kind of inputs in terms of energy and resources that we have nowadays. The internet is a great example. The internet is the most gargantuan technological structure in the history of the planet. It uses an incredible amount of energy. A single server farm will use as much as a mid-sized city. And that's not even counting the energy needed to build it, to maintain it, to replace the parts which are going all over, frying out all the time, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. It's not gonna last. And so while we're building, while we're disintermediating ourselves and disintermediating our households and beginning to disintermediate our community, gibberish is my native language. While we're doing this, we also do need to disintermediate the flow of knowledge and start getting that back in something that we do rather than something that is done for us. And there are simpler technologies. One example is amateur radio. Britain has a very large, very active ham radio community. I don't happen to know the fine details of getting a license, but it's not that challenging. And this is a situation where you can take 5 watts of power and some cheap electronic components and talk to somebody in China without having wires going from place to place. It's a very efficient technology. It worked very well in the 1920s. It's an option. So yes, information is a real issue. Yes, we can, I think there's every hope of maintaining some kind of information transfer. And the sooner individuals pick up and say, you know, this is something I want to work on, this is where I'm going to make a difference, the sooner that's going to happen. Okay, next question. Let's go all the way in the back with the green scarf.
In my own family, I haven't managed to really make a difference. One of my brothers is a trader, the other one is a plane pilot. Mm-hmm. And it's a bit like, well, you know, I'm already taking care of things. Mm-hmm. And apart from the egoistic side of going for natural products which are going to improve their health, or just the minimum separating my trash, that's enough for them to think mm-hmm. they're already doing something. Mm-hmm. How can you go further without becoming rejected, because then you become an inconvenience? Mm-hmm.
Well, you can't make anybody else make these changes, okay? This is why it has to start with your life, not with the lives of other people. Now, this can become an incredibly explosive issue. I know of marriages that have blown apart because one partner gets it and the other partner doesn't, and things went out of control from there. It's like it's very much like what happens when you have a couple who belongs to some devout religious community, and then one partner stops believing in that religion. The religion of progress has that same emotional power. I can't give advice for individuals in individual specific situations. I'm not you. I don't live your life. But you need to look around and see where can you personally make a difference. And it won't be in trying to talk someone else into doing something. What can you do with your own time in your own life that will contribute? In the brown sweater.
Thanks. I just start by saying that an amateur radio license in the UK is very easy to get. Yeah.
Glad to hear.
I was going to ask about the sort of collapse now and avoid the rush. I really like that idea. I loved it. And I guess my question is kind of, how do you walk the tightrope down between keeping one foot in sort of, not being too far out there, but still collapsing, in inverted commas, as fast as you can? I feel like I'm kind of stuck between these two possibilities.
It's a very common challenge. And to some extent, again, that has to be the compromise between the two has to be made on an individual basis. The concept of collapse now and avoid the rush, by the way. The idea is that if you simplify your life now, if you start living now the way you will be living after the next economic downturn, that's going to free up a lot of resources, a lot of time, and no small amount of money that you can proceed to put into setting things up so that you can, in fact, weather those changes with as few disasters as possible. Exactly what you do is going to depend on your own comfort level. Some people, I mean, there are people who don't mind being far out, possibly being extremely far out. But again, that's not a judgment that anyone else can make for you. There may be certain things that you, that for entirely personal reasons, you don't really feel you can do without, and that's fine. Really, I think anybody who's making a who's trying to do something other than just sort of bleating along with the flock is making a step in the right direction that needs to be honored. There's a lot of room, and there are not that many people making the necessary changes. So, for example, if do I gather correctly that you have an amateur radio license?
Yes, I do.
Delighted to hear it. If, for example, you want to put your work into helping other people in the green community get interested in that, learn how to do it, get their licenses, set up nets and so on, and that's what you can do, great. That's a contribution, and it's not one that a lot of other people are doing. You know, if you just can't bring yourself to let go of some of the perks and comforts, I understand. I mean, we all have things like that. I'm not living in a grass hut. I've done it. Not for a long period, but I have done it. It is a little uncomfortable. But so you have to choose where you personally will find your place. You find the place you're going to make your stand, and you do what you can with what you have where you are. So there is no simple straightforward rule. One concept I want to introduce at this point, which may help make some sense of all this, is of the sense that I don't have a nice, neat, easy recipe here, is the concept of dissensus. We've all heard about consensus, right? We all sit down, we come up with a common idea. It's a great thing if in a situation where there is one known answer and you can all sort of gravitate around it. We don't have that luxury. The concept of dissensus was come up with by a postmodern theorist, it was Ziarek. And her idea is that when nobody knows what the right answer is, you don't benefit by everybody coming up with a single answer and following it. If you're lost in the woods and you don't know the way back to camp, you and a dozen other people, sitting down, deciding where camp is and marching all toward it together is not your best plan. Your best plan is to send out searchers in different directions and all come back. And so dissensus applies the same logic. We don't know the best way to navigate the crises of the decades ahead. And I want to use that term because we're probably, certainly in America, very likely here as well, facing a real mess. It's going to be ugly. How best to navigate those crises is an unknown question at this point. So the best option we have is to try as many options as possible. And if everybody in this room takes a different route, I bet we find camp a lot faster. Okay. Yeah. The other Brownswell.
I understand what you're saying about not seeing progress in terms of the human race going on out to the stars and so on. But I wonder if you think that people do need to see their own individual lives in terms of progress, of getting an education, getting a job, you get your car, you get your house, you get your family, mm-hmm. you get a pension, and how that relates to the big themes that you're talking about. Do you think that we need to see progress in our own lives, or do you suggest that there's a different way of looking at our own lives?
I hope so, because you left out the rest of it. You get old and you die. Seriously, I think a lot of what drives the whole myth of progress, as most civil religions of its kind, is a desperate attempt to avoid the reality of the fact that we are none of us going anywhere except the cemetery. Whatever we may leave a little bit behind us in this world, we may accomplish something for good, but it's not cumulative. You don't necessarily take your degrees and your house and your children and your pension with you when you go. Most human beings throughout history have not believed in progress. The idea of progress is extremely recent. It's only really had a lot of popularity within about the last 300 years. There have been other periods where something like progress progress was believed in, the basic ideology of the Roman world, but it was progress that reached a plateau and stopped. You know, there was this time in the past, an age of chaos, the rule of the Titans in religious terms, the era before the Roman Empire in political terms, fill in the blank. And then you have Zeus or Augustus or whoever bashing in some heads, establishing peace, and there we are. Now, of course, that didn't work too well in the long run either. Choose a civil ideology, we'll eventually run into something it doesn't explain. But this idea of perpetual progress, that we always must be going someplace, we always must be improving and, quote, evolving. Evolution is not progress. Sit down with an evolutionary biologist sometime and let them explain that to you, because they have a lot to say about it. For most people, this has never been an issue until about the last 300 years. And it has been an issue over the last 300 years because we've been in a rapidly expanding economy driven by the breakneck exploitation of fossil fuel resources. And that has given the idea of progress in our lives as progress in our societies the plausibility of its hand. Now, that's, of course, a major part of the challenge. What do you do if that's not what you're going to get from here on in? If, as we look at the future, all of us, however young, however old, get to see at best a plateau, more likely increasing material deprivation and poverty. Because that is what we're talking about. We have the wealth that we have because there's so much unearned wealth, so much energy flowing through the system, maximizing the production of goods and services. As that goes away, so do the excess goods and services. So if those people who need to believe in progress are facing a shattering disconfirmation because they're not going to get it. And those people who can work their mind around some other way of understanding life are going to have a much better time dealing with the inevitable crises of our age. Does that make sense? Okay, next question. Flower vest.
We live in a society where we're extremely de-skilled. So the problem with sort of household economy is we don't know how to do these things. And one of the ways of getting around it is to have hobbies. Like you can have a hobby of gardening. You don't need to sort of think about, say, growing all your food at the moment. If you're growing about 20% of your food, you're developing the skills that you might need in 10 years' time that you might have been growing 90%. Same with dressmaking. Have the skill there. And that way you're developing the skills that you actually need and might come in really handy in 20 years' time. And you actually need to be doing it yourself. So maybe just think about these as hobbies that you can be doing in your part-time.
That's also something you can tell people if you need protective camouflage. It's just my hobby. You can't quite go, yes, the end of industrial civilization is my hobby. But still, two other resources I would strongly recommend, because yes, we have had a massive loss of practical skills. We don't do it because we let oil do it. I don't know what the figure is for the UK, but in the United States, in terms of raw energy, every single person has the equivalent of 300 slaves working 8-hour shifts 365 days a year, producing goods and services for them. Okay, and again, that's what produces our economy of abundance. We have those energy slaves. Unfortunately, they're kind of slipping off in the night on an underground railroad back to the Paleozoic, and it's really rather frustrating. So that is a problem. One resource is your elderly relatives who learned this stuff in the 40s and 50s when they were growing up. Talk to them. I don't know whether this is true in the UK. In America, most people in their 20s and 30s have no idea how to cook. They've never done it. They pick up dinner from the deli. I send them to their grandmothers and their great aunts and say, learn how to do something other than stick something in the microwave. You will save a lot of money. And also you'll be in a position where you can extort food to hold you over times when the shelves may be bare at the store. And the range of other things. Talk to your elders. And talk to them about, okay, how do I do this? How do I cook? How do I clean when I don't have, you know, washing machine with a control panel that looks like a jet fighter to do it for me? And so on. The other thing Another of the temporary but very real advantages of the internet is that you can download outdated books on any subject you can imagine. You can also, in a country like this, find many of them in the older libraries. I hope your libraries don't purge their collections the way ours do. At any rate, old books on crafts, on practical functions, there's a lot of them. There's a lot of extremely valuable information. Note for the ham radio operators among us, old handbooks from the 1920s. Here is some scrap and how you build a radio from it. Hoot. A very nice hobby. But at the same time, these are all productive tasks. Can you get a small appliance repaired in this country? You can.
But most people will try the
place. As I say, you're well ahead of us then. The small appliance repair trade crashed and burned in America back in the 1980s. My guess is that as things wind down, that is going to be a huge growth industry. And if you know how to take a defunct toaster or something like that and make it workable again, when there are no longer toasters coming off the container ships from China, you're going to be a very popular person. There's a lot of things like that. Especially with, as we move away from the electrical technologies back into lower energy technologies, if you know how to take an old, broken down example of saying and refurb it, or if you know how to make one, there we go. So there's a whole world of things in the realm of reskilling that can be gotten into. There are a lot of resources available. It's just a matter of rolling up your sleeves, talking to people, getting the information, having fun with it. Okay, next question. Pink sweater way in the back. Not quite all the way.
I'd like to know what you think about medicine and healthcare in the future, because thinking about progress, you say, is religion. Mm-hmm. I mean, we can actually see tangible benefits. Mm-hmm. Many of us sitting here probably wouldn't be sitting here mm-hmm. were it not for progress in that area. Mm-hmm. I think that's the thing I find very difficult to mm-hmm. imagine not mm-hmm. progressing or mm-hmm. being there, and what you think about that.
It is. We're kind of ahead of the curve on this in the United States, as we don't have much of a healthcare system anymore. seriously, the so-called healthcare reform is basically a system for paying off the pharmaceutical industry for their election campaigns. A very large number of Americans these days can't afford conventional healthcare, and an even larger number don't want it because our healthcare system is very corrupt and very dysfunctional, and you are as likely to be harmed as to be helped. And so the program is to make people pay for a service whether they want to use it or not. It's not working well. It's a mess. I'm here because of penicillin. Unfortunately, penicillin is being used in ways that are rendering it increasingly non-functional. The failure of antibiotics due to antibiotic resistance, largely as a function of factory farming, in which antibiotics are handed out like candy to the animals. What happens if you put subclinical doses of antibiotics into an animal's feed? It gets bigger a little faster. It weighs a little more at slaughter time. You can make a few pence more per pound. Okay? And for that, we're sacrificing one of the great health achievements of modern history. Oh well. There are alternative healthcare modalities that are useful, but all of them were in existence when antibiotics came about. I don't know of one that wasn't. And a lot of people still died of infections. Okay. It's an ugly situation. We are very likely going to move back into a situation where, for example, if a 7-year-old comes down with scarlet fever, as I did at that age, they may not make it. I was put on horse doctor's doses of penicillin and I came through. A lot of children did it 100 years ago. 100 years from now, a lot of children may not make it also. I wish I could say something that would sugarcoat that extremely unpalatable reality. As it is, we do have alternative methods. We need to get them back into circulation and back into practice in the homes, as well as in terms of professionals, as quickly as possible, because that's what we're going to have. A good knowledge of basic sanitation and of home nursing, some other skills that have dropped largely out of practice but need to be recovered, those would be well worth bringing into the mix as well. But there is no easy answer. Okay. Next. Dark blue way in the back.
Hi, my name is Jane. You've talked about the most common myths that people cling to in every common society. What do you find are the most common myths in the kind of communities that you talk to, say, like environmentalist communities? Do you find that many people will reject the myths of the large society, but not realize they're just substituting their own?
Actually, most of them believe in the same myths. It's just, you put a coat of green spray paint on the myths. We can continue to progress using solar energy. We can continue to progress using this or that or the other. Our middle class lifestyles are non-negotiable. I have to give Dick Cheney one point in his credit. When he said that the American lifestyle is non-negotiable, he was right in one sense. No possible negotiation can save it, nor can anything else. The alternative myth, which is actually a version of the same thing, is the mythology of apocalypse. The idea that we are all going to die next Thursday. Or in 2030 is, I think, the hot one nowadays. There are a lot of people who have been cherry-picking climate research to come up with a set of reasons why we will all be, the human race will be extinct by 2030. And they're very enthusiastic about this. And if you point out that that's supported by about 3% of the research, they will get very angry. I've had this experience on a number of occasions, and it was not until I'd watched this process at work that I realized the point of it, which is that if we're all going to be dead by 2030, then there's nothing we can do, then there's nothing we have to do, therefore, hop in the SUV pedal to the metal, we might as well enjoy it while it's here. And that's it's basically the same thing. It does really come down to the myth of progress again. If we can't have that Star Trek future metastasizing across the galaxy, hey, then at least we can have the biggest, loudest, shiniest mass die-off that any species ever had. We're number one. So it is really an interesting thing to watch in practice. But that's really the only more or less competing myth. And it plays into a very deeply held set of rhetoric in our society. Because, as I mentioned, people who are protesting the status quo always say, you've got to do what I say or something really awful will happen. And the people who are supporting the status quo are saying, nonsense, that's just superstition. And the people who are supporting the status quo always win those debates. The something awful will happen people, they have their scripted role. If you take debates over whatever society's doing and go back over the last, say, 100 years of different debates, watch them. You'll see the same rhetoric being replayed over and over again. I compared it in one of my blog posts to ritual theater, like passion play. or you know, every man. You've got to have the figure speaking up for sin and so on and so forth. There are all these roles that have to be filled, and we do that. So, next question. I can't see the shirt, but white hair directly back there.
Thank you very much. I recognize the end of the world of the week from the blog, so yeah. Thank you for that. Low technology toolkit. Mm-hmm. I'm picking up a little bit of homebrew. Mm-hmm. I'm picking up a little bit of gardening in relation to that, maybe a solar oven, mm-hmm. something like that. And I'm just wondering what other pieces of equipment or knowledge might be good for my low technology toolkit.
Whatever fires your passion, whatever makes you go, wow, I want to do that. Because that energy is the thing that needs to be harnessed. Please do not take this up as you would take up doing penance. I'm going to cook in a solar oven for the good of my soul. You know, well, please, let's not go there. We need to harness the excitement and the kind of obsessive compulsive interest that you get in a hobby setting. I'm sure you all know people who are into whatever hobby and devote embarrassing amounts of time and energy to it because that's what brings them joy. Let's do the same thing. Doom can be your hobby.
Thank you.
Okay. Way in the back there in the blue shirt.
Hi. First of all, I'd just like to say this is fun as well as being useful, so thank you for that.
I'm glad to hear that.
I'll try and formulate a succinct question. I would like to believe that I'm flawed.
Perhaps we can come back to psychology, but just before I go ahead with the question, can I just give a very short example, which doesn't really relate directly, as to how we changed as a society in the UK.
And go ahead.
That example would be drink driving, where in the stretch of one or two generations, that has changed from I do it all the time and try not to get caught, through to nearly everybody believes it's ethically unacceptable, and broadly speaking, people don't do it. So I'm positing here that governments can change things when there's a will. Second part of my question is, I see myself as a typical, somewhat aware individual. I think I'm highly willing to change if that is part of a communal solution where I can see a result.
Mm-hmm.
Against that, I'm too selfish to want to, forgive the phrase, pee into the wind. Now, I'm suggesting that there are a million like me,
mm-hmm.
for every 1,000 perhaps,
mm-hmm.
who are well motivated enough to do what you're suggesting,
mm-hmm.
And that we could move forward with appropriate leadership and a government-level initiatives, which I suspect you don't believe in for one instant.
Oh, no, the thing is, I think if such a thing could be obtained, that would be very nice. I don't know how well you're doing over here in the search for competent leaders. We've had very little luck in the United States for some generations now, and so the search is ongoing, but it just does not look very good. So if you do find a competent leader who gets it and is willing, that would be absolutely great. In the meantime, I'm suggesting that those people who are willing to actually roll up their sleeves and at least in any way possible start getting that mimesis thing underway, get to work. Among other things, and you correct me if I'm wrong, the campaign against drink driving did not begin with government. It began with citizens groups, with people just saying, this is killing people. And it began with a very small number of people saying, no, we're going to draw a hard line here. We're going to make a case for this. Mimesis cut in. Sooner or later, MPs figured out, hey, here's a gravy train we can ride. And everyone started jumping on the bandwagon. Somebody has to start the bandwagon rolling. It might as well be you. We are actually, and I'm sorry to say, out of time at this point. I will be available for casual discussion over lunch. I will be available for the general discussion
afternoon.
Whatever, I'll be around. So thank you all. You've been a great audience and had some very good questions. And let's go for it.
Well, thank you very much, John Michael Greer. It's not as much what he says, is where he's coming from in what he says, so it's much appreciated. How one person can make a difference, and that one person is you. You've got the message. So we'll stop now, have a lunch break. It's not really stopping, we're just changing and hopefully developing and continuing the conversation. But we will at that point be mingling with the other half, but please note that we're on a slightly staggered lunch. So could you be back here in an hour's time, 12:40, to move on to the... Do I mean that? No, I mean 1:40, so we're ready for the next session. Could I also point out, in the refectory as well as refreshment, there is a bookshop around the corner. There are a selection of books there. Particularly if you're new to the school and you'd like to know a little bit more about what we do, and particularly in the economics, can I recommend this book, which is hot off the press, called One World, One Wealth. It's a series of essays by our principal, who's the former head of economics, who is here today, and is happy to sign your book, the book, for no charge. It's £6. But I think it's quite a nice introduction to the sort of general flavour of the approach to economics here. Thank you very much. See you back here.